Welcome to Board Gamers. We've got, Jim, it just says blah, 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 games, blah, 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 stuff on the auto queue.
Oh, yeah, sorry about that, mate. We ran out of budget this week and we couldn't afford the script writers.
But don't we always write the script?
Oh, yeah. Well, maybe we price ourselves out of the market. I'm sure we make something up instead.
Okay, cool. Welcome to Board Gamers. Blah, 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 games, blah, blah, stuff.
Awesome. Coming up on this week's, blah.
It's too late. I'm now spectating. Jim shall not pass.
There, and he had this big 12-inch record.
News! Well, luckily for this section, I never need a script. I introduce it every single week. So it's the noobs. News.
Oh, dear.
See,
oh,
I don't need a script after all.
Oh, yeah, we're going to have to get those writers back, I think, at some point.
It's shocking. It's not.
But news, it's written on the screen, so, you know, you're covered.
So it is.
Yeah.
There you go.
There you go.
So what is going on in the world of gaming news this week?
Ooh, well, the big story, there's a bit of a seismic shift going on, Greg, at the moment in the world of console gaming. The Xbox One, for those who weren't aware, in fact, you're probably not aware of it in this country because it doesn't apply to this country. There was a price cut of $50 in the United States a couple of weeks ago on the Xbox One. It's now available for $350, and it's having fantastic effects on Xbox One sales. That combined with a bunch of new bundles they've brought out recently. And of course, the big exclusives like Sunset Overdrive, the Master Chief Collection, being, you know, doing well and getting good reviews. So basically, Microsoft announced today they've had a big uptick in sales, and they've outsold the PlayStation 4 over the last couple of weeks. And
fantastic!
They've now shipped 10 million consoles to retailers, so they're very pleased about that.
Wow! I mean, obviously, that's not actually consoles sold, but
no.
Even so, that's really, really positive. We wish them well. In the world of games, there's only one story that needs talking about. Oh, we'll talk about a few, but one that's very, very important to me. In the world of playing cards, you know, you can have a standard deck, or you could have a theme deck and things like this.
Sure,
and,
sure.
Obviously, we've had Paul Zenon on with his Zed-Ray deck, which is very, very good. But
he put those in his mouth.
He did put them in his mouth. Very impressive. But this one's got me very excited. It's just a playing card deck, but it is the Goonies playing
the
card
Goonies.
Deck. It's amazing.
That's awesome.
I want anything with Goonies. That's amazing.
Yes, that is like the most archetypal 80s movie.
Seriously.
It is brilliant.
It is brilliant.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
The Goonies playing cards. I just want to be able
what
to
What is
play.
It like, top trumps of the Goonies?
No, it's literally just playing cards, but with the Goonies feet.
Oh, okay. That is absolutely awesome. There's a nice bit of news here. A gamer who suffers from terrible, persistent migraines has been immortalized as an NPC in the upcoming Witcher 3 Wild Hunt game after sending a letter to the developer CD Projekt thanking them for all the therapeutic effects playing the previous installment, The Witcher 2, had on his condition. He said, "I still can't believe it. They're such amazing people." So,
Also in board games, the very, very popular and award-winning game Dixit has now got a Dixit Odyssey coming out. We're going to be looking at Dixit in a show coming up very, very soon. But Dixit Odyssey adds a little bit to this sort of picture-based game, including the ability to try to trap and ensnare some of your opponents. And it also can pay up to 12 players now. So that's a fantastically big party game there.
Excellent. Cool, cool. Autobiographical family drama That Dragon, Cancer, the story of raising a small boy with a terminal illness, has launched a Kickstarter campaign to raise $85,000 and wrap up development. Okay, new releases this week. Far Cry 4 on pretty much everything other than Nintendo. GTA 5 on Xbox One and PS4. That's going to be really cool. Dragon Age Inquisition on everything. Watch Dogs on Wii U. Hatsune Miku Project Diva F2 on PS3 and Vita. And my personal favourite this week, Death Skid Marks on OXX and PC. Sounds weird. Review.
Democracy? Democracy. Democracy is not what these people need. Hell, it's not even what they want. America's been trying to install democracies in nations for a century, and it hasn't worked one time.
What a difference a year makes. You'd be forgiven for thinking, after last year's outing for what is undeniably the perennial FPS shooter franchise, that Call of Duty has failed to move with the times. Brand new consoles? Same old COD. What were they thinking with the likes of Titanfall, the true future of shooters with its incredible next-generation fast-paced gameplay, ready to steal our allegiances? Well, just as the series reinvented itself with Call of Duty Modern Warfare, now too it has once again emerged triumphantly from uninspiring, overly ground-based gameplay and progressively far-fetched storytelling in the form of Call of Duty Advanced Warfare. Forget your slightly exaggerated near-future realpolitik and make way for mid-21st century cyber weaponry and chicanery, along with, of course, the absolutely awesome Kevin Spacey.
And that's where I come in.
With the new farer future setting of this new COD comes the game's breakthrough element, releasing the player into a freer, faster, and more fluid elevation-driven play space. Thanks to your exo-suit, an exoskeleton that grants the wearer superhuman-like agility, power, and speed, the player now has the freedom to traverse the environment like never before, leaping on top of buildings, boost dodging out of harm's reach, and grappling Batman-style across long stretches of terrain. All that combined with special modifications that let you slow time in order to destroy a group of enemies, a mute device to silence your movement, and cloaking device to conceal your position, and you've got all the drool-worthy tech tools at your disposal to dispose of your opponents in a variety of fresh and satisfying ways. As for the controls, they are as tight and easy to access as always, a long-standing quality of the series. The fun doesn't end there, though, as COD Advanced Warfare features some of the best-looking in-game cutscenes ever made. At moments, the characters seem so alive and engaging, you really will feel like you're watching an actual movie.
Whoa, that's totally trippy, man.
And fortunately for us, the story itself is a good one, with Kevin Spacey adding much-needed gravitas to an admittedly predictable, yet well-written and well-performed campaign that'll take you about 6 hours to get through.
What about multiplayer? It's all about multiplayer, you poncy git. I want to know how many kids I can make cry with endless headshots when I play deathmatch.
Hush now, oppressed mass. I was just getting to that. Yes, I'm all too aware that for many of you, COD is all about the online stuff. And even though I'm not the best judge of this mode personally, as I'm always more drawn to story-driven games, I have to say Advanced Warfare hits the sweet spot with an impressive array of 12 modes, 13 maps, a generously high prestige level limit, custom classes, perks, and loadouts. Unlike in Titanfall, where the matchmaking system is totally broken, making entry for new players much harder than it should be, Advanced Warfare has an effective way of easing online oddities like myself into the whole thing with the impressive Combat Readiness Program, a bot-based mode to hone your skills before hitting the multiplayer battlefield proper. A vital tool to help non-hardcore onliners practice, and a very welcome one. For those of you who prefer a positive interaction with your friends, rather than screaming expletives at them down a headset as you blow their heads off, Exo Survival Mode will do just the job. It's a round-based survival game-type mode that keeps going indefinitely until the players are all defeated. Be warned, each round the fight goes up a difficulty level, and if you get really good at it, expect it to last a very long time. The quality of Call of Duty Advanced Warfare is an almost unexpected surprise, for all the right reasons. People rightly questioned whether the series would go the way of so many others before it, in not surviving the transition to a new generation, being stuck in the old way of doing things and just not being able to move on. How wrong we were! Excellent control inputs combined with fresh, fast, and agile gameplay, wrapped in an exciting and beautifully rendered future cyber dystopia with an ever-present and significantly improved multiplayer experience, makes this a game I can't recommend highly enough. Modern Warfare is dead. Long live Advanced Warfare.
So, Call of Duty Advanced Warfare, is it the FPS that you need to get, or is it firing blanks?
You could probably tell from the tone of that review that, it really is not firing blanks this year at all.
No.
It's a series which, of course, is the iconic series FPS that you can get in recent years, in the last decade or so in particular. But recent installments have been a bit, you know, behind the eight ball and not been so exciting to play. Not this year, though. They've really added this extra dimension to the gameplay, the sort of elevation changes, the speed, the agility they've added to the game. They've really freshened it up.
And my favourite thing by far is the fact that it includes the ability to play offline. And that was a huge bugbear of Titanfall.
We can fight against bots, you know, you can do this combat readiness program. And for Greg and I are not the sort of the biggest online FPS players, so it's really good for us, which you'll see a bit of later in the show, actually, when we take on some of those bots.
So let's see what you've given it in the way of star ratings.
Have a look.
Five stars!
Perfect score. Yeah.
Great game.
And I gather it deserves every single bit of it.
If you haven't played one in a while, you got to pick it up, seriously. So let's have a look at the boredometer, though.
Board
see how
rating.
Boring it is.
Right,
not very boring at all. There's always, you know, the slight possibility of, you know, getting a bit frustrated and rage quitting, you know, if you can't do the multiplayer so well. But, you know, no reason whatsoever not to try it if you like FPSs. It's a great game.
So there you go. Call of Duty, almost perfect score. It's one to get.
After the break.
I know what I'm doing. Oh, you've engaged.
I have engaged.
Alpha Tango, Apple Orange, have you engaged?
I don't want to go into it, but it's been a nightmare.
So, Call of Duty Advanced Warfare. I'm excited about playing this. Jim's played quite a bit of it. I've played
gonna
about
kill
seven
me some bots.
10 minutes worth. This is the Exo Survival mode, which is very good that you can actually play in a local co-op mode against waves of ever-increasing difficulties of bad dudes. So
difficulty are we going to do? I think regular.
I think
I'm
regular.
I'm feeling very hardened or veteran today.
Definitely regular.
Regular, yeah.
I haven't played this pretty much at all, so
I'll pick the retreat because it's kind of it. You know, it's kind of pretty place to pretty place for a little stroll and a kind of killing spree. So yeah, that's my thought.
How much cover do bushes give you though? That's the question.
So that's a very good question. We'll find out in a minute.
So on the very brief time I have played this, I can tell you that you get to choose your exo suit, and you can go for light or heavy or some other
or support.
Support
kind of halfway in between. And your exo suit gives you various abilities, allow you to move around the map more quickly and in a more agile way. And I'm going to go for light because I like.
I'm going to go for heavy because I'd like to stay alive for a few seconds.
A few seconds, okay, fair enough.
Only a few extra seconds.
Mate. Okay, right. Oh, okay, it's starting.
It's starting.
I just want to hit the plan.
Get in a corner and just survive.
Okay, I'm running around because I'm the cool army dude.
Yeah.
I know what I'm doing. Oh, you've engaged.
I have engaged.
Alpha Tango, Apple Orange, have you engaged?
Wow, okay. I'm just literally in a room full of dudes all killing me. I'm dead already. There you go. That's a good start.
Fucking hell.
I'll come and rescue you.
Come rescue me. I'm bleeding out.
You killed my friend.
15 seconds
die.
To kill me.
Well, I stood in the room that they all decided to meet in. So come save me. You've got 8 seconds. Come to me.
I want to shoot him just in the elbow.
Where am I?
Where are you?
I'm in the main room. It's too late. I'm now spectating.
He's spectating. Oh, sorry about that, mate. I was busy, like, taking in the decor.
I'm a dead dude who can look around. I'm in some weird sort of biodome, so that's lovely.
Why don't you, like, show some nice shots for the, you know, for the fans, Jesse?
Well, this is it. Well,
I'm in the pool. I'm having a nice swim. I'm shooting people. You know,
so
it's a great afternoon.
No pressure for Jim here, but basically, if he completes this level, then I come back alive and we can carry on together. If he dies, then it's kind of like playing Stuck in the Mud as a kid, where you're all stuck in the mud. We're all screwed. So no pressure, Jim.
I did it.
Hey!
Hey! Has that taught you something about this already, Greg?
It's taught me that don't stay in the room where they're all going to run into. Yeah,
that is true. All right. Oh, can I? Oh, I've upgraded my weapon. Excellent.
I don't even know where I am.
Yeah, I earned a bit of sort of kudos there for taking out that wave individual. There you are.
Well, that's you.
Oh. Don't shoot me again. You did that. Remember, you did that in Doom. That was really mean.
But then, now, Jim can do all these massive jumps. I can only do little
you
jumps.
You can do little jumps, yeah.
I can do little jumps.
I suggest you find a nice bit of cover somewhere.
I just want to hide in a corner and survive. Is that bad?
Yeah, it's supposed to be like a brave army dude.
I am a brave army dude. Yeah.
It's going to start. It's going to start again.
The fit is going to hit the Shan. It's going to happen.
Nice little diversion, I see you did there.
That's a dude.
Okay, I'm hiding down here. I think this is a cool spot. We should stick together, really. We should stick together. Where have you gone?
I'm out in the open where all the guys are once again. They seem
why
to
would you
find
do that?
Me.
You know what happened last time?
Well, I'm not trying to. They're all shooting at me. Okay, you're going to have to survive me again. Help me again.
Are you not down again? Are you bleeding out again?
Not quite. I am killing all the dudes, though. So this
that's good. Well, that's progress. So, yeah, this is the...
I'm bleeding out now, but I have taken...
Oh, he's down again.
I've
right,
taken
okay.
six dudes with me,
I'm
though.
Coming.
Come save me,
Mobile
Jim!
Mobile me!
Come save me!
Shoot him first! I have 30 seconds, you got to get to
come
me.
Come on, man!
There I am! Come save me! Come save me, Jim, you're my only hope!
Oh, but they're taking me out.
Hold me! Revive me!
Yay! And I'm back in the game.
Oh, I'm nearly dead now. I've had enough of this. Oh, I've got to have a break. I've got to go have a fag break over here.
Okay, well, I'm...
Can't think about it.
I'm giving chase. There's one dude.
Yeah. Yes, we did it again. We survived another round.
Fantastic.
We've only got about a minute left here, so we'll see how far we get through the next round. But we're doing quite well here, actually. We thought we were going to die in the first 5 seconds.
Well, I have a tendency of dying in the first 5 seconds, but at least this time I took some people out.
I thank you for your sacrifice, Greg. It's
very I did take most people with me, so can I upgrade my expo?
I'm not sure I want the proper ability. Anyway. There's so many abilities that come with your exosuit and your courses. You play through this mode, you gather more abilities as you go, and you unlock more of the good weapons. We've got some of the basic weapons here.
Let's stick together.
This is good.
Stop running away from me. You're faster than me. I've got I'm walking Titan, basically.
Well, don't chase me. Don't follow me, mate.
So I don't think we can get very far into this round. We've got about 20 seconds left, or so that will give
me... This is a brief look at a sort of multiplayer
just
mode.
Just enough time to die again, I think.
If you like playing with your friends and you like playing against bots, we can customise the difficulty. There's a good one for you.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Excellent game.
I'm being
very
shot.
Enjoyable.
Earlier this year, Greg and I attended the Salute Convention in London, where Greg got to interview Andy Foster, the head of Heresy Miniatures.
So I'm here today with Andy, the self-proclaimed Dark Overlord of Heresy Miniatures here, who's here to talk about all sorts of things, 28mm fantasy and sci-fi. Hello, Andy, please, sir.
Hi,
yeah, thank you. I'm doing fine, yeah. Very tired from wandering around this rather large expo, but we're doing well. So how are you doing? It's been an early morning and a long day so far, I presume.
It's been an early morning, it's been a late night, and an early morning and a late night before that.
How have you found today? Has there been a lot of interest? Have you sold lots of things?
It's been a good day so far, considering. I've had a few things, like the re-release, because it was the Heresy's 12th birthday
last week.
So for a re-release, brought out the old Netherlord model.
The Netherlord.
Huge spiky demon lord is in the cabinet over there. We've had a few of those, a bit last minute, but we managed to bring some.
And I gather you've sold out of those.
Sold out of that. I'll be doing some more, obviously.
at least for next salute, if not beforehand.
Well, not for next salute. He'll be gone by then. He's a limited edition. Fantastic. He's a real mold ripper, so he's all spikes and evilness. And he pulls the silicon away, and he's a nightmare to cast. But if people want to get hold of him, then for the next few weeks I shall be making them.
There you go.
They've not stopped asking for the last few years.
Speaking of mould ripping, I've been following with anticipation the creation of an exceedingly impressive dragon. And I gather you've had all sorts of problems with moulds and issues and cutting it into bits and the like. He's finally available, or he has been for some years, but he's finally available to the collector.
He is now shipping. Let's say that.
Shipping?
So, yes.
That's now a Kickstarter shipping. Term. You may get him eventually next year sometime.
No. Last year I was having to say you may get him eventually next year. But now I'm actually casting it myself.
So what would you say is your most popular range? What sells best of all? You've got a broad range of figures. There's a rather very, very impressive figure range I've seen that you do, which... emulates a certain BBC staple of the Doctor variety and
what do you mean?
Various people who could look like that but aren't necessarily of that brand. So.
Various people who could look like that, yes.
Yes, I think they say too.
I don't see it myself, obviously. that's a popular range, one I hope to keep doing, one which I'd like to get a proper license for, but the BBC want Toys R Us money for it. So there's me, there's a few other companies do similar ones, obviously, but I like to think mine are the best. I intend to do a few more for that because I love that show. Absolutely love it.
It's a fantastic show.
And I do them for myself, really. I just happen to sell those ones, you know what I mean?
Always good. So that aside, what's your best, apart from a Neverlord today, what's your best-selling range or best-selling figure, would you say?
It's varied. The guys in the trench coats have got some trench coat gangers there that people love, sort of cyberpunk type things, with the old shaved head and sunglasses and stuff. Very Matrix-y, very cyberpunk. They're very popular. People keep asking me to do some opponents for them, but now the dragon's finished sculpting with, I can finally get on and make some new figures. The undead does well, the demons do, everything does well. It's just I can't, because I'm a one-man show most of the year. I've got some help today from some friends. But the rest of the year, I'm a one-man show, which means I do all the casting and packing and stuff like that.
Well, it sounds like you're extremely
I don't get a lot of chances to sculpt. Well, now the dragon's out of the way, I will get some chances to sculpt. So I'm going to do things like, once the dragon queue's sorted, I'll run a Kickstarter for some plastic skeletons.
Fantastic.
Because for me, skeletons that exist out there are not proper skeletons.
Are we drawing inspiration from Harry Harryhausen?
Mr. Harryhausen, Lord Harryhausen. without Ray Harryhausen, I wouldn't be doing this now. I'd probably have a well-paid job.
But you wouldn't enjoy it half as much.
Oh, no. What?
So obviously you want to get back to sculpting your first love. What's the future for Heresy? What do we expect to see at Salute 2015?
Plastic skeletons.
Plastic skeletons and takeaway dragons.
Possibly plastic ghouls, possibly plastic zombies, possibly plastic sci-fi troopers. Depends how well the Kickstarter goes and how much I've got sculpted for it. We'll have the dragon here, we'll have other large spiky demon things probably, because I shall stop doing that one in a month or two probably, but I'll have one to replace it, or two to replace it, or, you know, depends on how well things go now that the dragon sculpting is out of the way, because it's Heresy Reborn. I'm really excited about it. I get to do stuff for myself and for the company again instead of just solving dragon problems. I don't want to go into it, but it's been a nightmare.
Well, it's I'm glad to see
now
that
the nightmare
dragon
is over.
Has been reborn and is looking stunning and fantastic. Thank you for talking.
Hopefully,
to me
I'll have
today.
A painted one.
That'll be good as well. Thank you.
Cheers. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Bye.
Cheers.
Still to come.
I feel the ring, Greg.
Do you?
It's burning.
Oh dear, that's probably the curry you had the other night
with my 8-foot whip.
Well, that sounds a remarkably kinky. So for our quick look this week, Jim has taken on Shadow of Mordor, the excited and much anticipated game.
I feel the ring, Greg.
Do you?
It's burning.
Oh dear, that's probably the curry you had the other night.
Oh, that's true, yeah. I wish the doctor about that.
So, Shadow of Mordor, or basically Arkham Asylum in Middle-earth, as I...
Basically. It's basically a cross between Arkham Asylum, or Arkham City, and Assassin's Creed. It's basically those two games combined into one. Which is pretty cool, actually.
It is pretty cool. So we've decided to do a quick look at it. We could have done a challenge with it, but we decided it would be absolutely pointless, because whatever we did, it would be very, very clear that Jim shall not pass.
How dare you?
Did you like
I saw what you did there.
A little bit of Lord of the Rings reference. Anyway, so he's going around, and he can phase in between this sort of ethereal elfin sort of warrior business, and basically...
Run away! I shouldn't have attacked them. Oh no.
You've annoyed the dogs now. That was a bad, bad
Who
idea.
Let them out?
Who let the dogs?
They're coming after you. Oh, they're going to eat you. Oh, and now there's a nasty orca dude.
I want to climb up the wall, but why won't I?
I think one of the exciting things I really, really like about this is the combat system, which is very, very similar to the Batman one. I believe it was made on the same engine, wasn't it?
Quite possibly, yes. So, these are horrible creatures. Basically, the storyline is that you are a sort of a fallen ranger. You were sort of killed. In fact, you were denied death by the Black Hand, one of Sauron's evil servants, and you've now been combined with a wraith, an elven fallen wraith who doesn't remember who he is and is trying to find out who he is and take out Sauron. And you're sort of combined within those two worlds, sort of stuck between worlds of the living and the dead. As you can see here, I'm sort of in spirit form, and then I can sort of leap back into the normal world and be a ranger gentleman as well, running
so
around.
So for the Lord of the Ring of Files out there, he's basically a nice Nazgul. He's going around with his ability to be sort of undead and ethereal while beating up people, which is cool.
Let's take out some bad guys, shall we?
One of the mechanics I really, really like about this is he's looking to kill all the gribbly bad guys as he can, but he's going to come across a certain captain, certain named characters, and he really wants to take them out because it's good for him. However, if he doesn't, and having watched him play this, there's a very good chance he's not going to be able to. Then what happens is they then sort of get leveled up. They get
look at that,
recognized for their ability to kill you, and it makes them harder to beat next time.
It does. It's a real incentive, in fact, to... am I going to chop his head off?
That was
a humiliation there. Yes, it's a really good incentive to sort of, look after your life, because when you die, these captains, these wannabe sort of rulers of Middle-earth from the Uruk-hai or Orc perspective, level up and they gain more power and more influence, and so you really don't want to allow them something like that, because of course, if you die too many times and they defeat too many times, they become very powerful and difficult to defeat.
But it's a bit of a double-edged sword, isn't it?
It is.
If you don't beat them, they get worse, which is not going to help you beat them the next time. So
it's a nice mechanic.
And they have a tendency of all turning up en masse. It's not unheard of for having sort of like 20 orcs.
Oh, come great, look, look at all these guys. Oh my God.
And four or five of the captains trying to beat the crap out of you.
This is where you have to be really, just like in the Batman games, you've got to be really fast and flowing in your attacks. I'm not doing at the moment, of course.
Throw a batarang! Oh no, wrong game.
These guys have got shields and you have to jump over and hit them from the other side.
Which again, very similar to some of the Batman
mechanics. Again, just like the enemies who have riot shields in
and pikes and things like that, yeah. But
gotta run.
It's a glorious looking game, and the theme is ever present in this one. I love the fact that it's got this whole storyline and the art and this and this orc captain mechanic.
Run away! I'm not really showing off very well here, I do apologise.
I think that's one of the things that's worth bearing in mind, that there is this balance between running away and facing. A tactful retreat is not necessarily a bad thing when you're outnumbered sort of 30-1 and having your hand
handed to you. Like I said, when you do die, you know, they level up and they'll be even harder to defeat at a later time.
There's loads of them.
Oh my God. Look at that, all the skills, the dodge roll. And basically it's a big open world, so you get to explore it and there are various challenges you can take on, not just the main storyline, but you can try and take on. And, oh, here we go, here is a captain. Okrum Rabble Rouser. He sounds like a jolly fine chap.
Fantastic. So
I can sort of punch him here and stun him and then do a quick fire move.
Ah, look at that. So,
look at that. Oh.
Jim's going to try to take him out ASAP because there's about to be another 100 orcs turn up. And, just like that, there you
just
go.
Just like that, I've got to get out of here.
No. I really like this game. I think it looks beautiful. It plays very well.
There's the odd little tedium in terms of movement, which always happens when you're playing these sort of, you know, Assassin's Creed style sort of leaping over obstacles kind of games. But apart from that, it looks great, plays great. The characters are very nice. The storyline is compelling. It's interesting. It's sort of set before Lord of the Rings. Gollum is in the game as well.
Gollum,
which is pretty cool.
Yes, if you're a Lord of the Rings fan, this really is a must. If you're not a Lord of the Rings fan, I still think it's a game that will appeal to you. I think it looks like it's going to sort of take its place amongst the sort of the Arkham series as a very good sort of third person sort of thing.
For Gondor and my wife and our sheep and things. Yes, Gondor.
I think it's all over.
Oh no, it's all over.
Challenge. So it's our challenge segment, and once again we're going to be inviting back the Master of Mayhem himself, Mr. Zach Owen, who's going to be doing some crazy stuff as usual. So let's see if we can get hold of you, Zach. Come in, Zach.
Hello.
We can see you. That's a start. Can you hear us, Zach?
Yep.
Can you hear us?
Hello. Yes, I can hear you.
Fantastic. And what are you going to be doing for us this week on the show?
Today I will be whipping balloons with my 8-foot whip.
Well, that sounds remarkably kinky there. What type of whip are you using today?
Today I'll be using an 8-foot stock whip.
Well, that means very little to me. I don't know about my whip. But most importantly, is it the one that Indiana Jones uses?
Yes, indeed, it would be. You can even swing from this one.
Well, we won't be needing to do that. So stay where you are, and we're going to start getting the game we're going to be playing set up. So, there is only one game we could really do. We have a man with a whip. There could be only one game. Of course, without that, it is Octodad. I know you didn't expect me to say that. In fairness, we did look at all the Indiana Jones games and from the original LucasArts ones to the Lego ones, and they're very adventure-y.
They're good games, but they're not really games you can use for a challenge.
They're not very challenging. So we decided to go
with... better than the dexterous challenge that is Octodad, Greg.
Exactly. Well, this is it. I mean, you've got sort of big, long things that look a bit like whips, big, long tentacles and the like. So, so the challenge is going to be is Jim has to get through the first level and get himself married. So he needs to get himself dressed up while Zach is going to be trying to pop 16 balloons with his whip. So let's get it ready. So you ready, Jim? And should we get Zach ready as well? And I say get ready. Let's get started. Okay, so Jim straight away is falling all over the place. And wow, look at Zach go. He's oh dear.
I got my tie.
So you're already half a bit of the way there. That's good. Zach in the meantime is smashing through those balloons.
Oh, you better get a move on, Jim. Jim's got through the door. That's a good start. So you've got to find and wear your tux next. Wow, Zach is just zooming through this. You better get a move on.
Come on, the door. Come on.
Dressing room here. Well,
okay, well, I found my tux.
Awesome. I can tell you, having played Octodad, it's ridiculously hard to do the controllers. It goes against everything. Oh my God, Zach's actually got his whip caught on the fence. So he's got his backup whip. He's got two balloons left.
What? Two balloons?
He's smashing this. Oh my God.
I haven't got through the door.
But he's struggling to pop them. No, one balloon left. It's not going to be down
slow
to the wire.
Come on. There's banana peels. Oh, I've slipped on the banana peel.
But this is the most resilient balloon I have ever seen. So you might be all right. He's
my bow tie.
Get your bow tie.
Please don't pop it.
You're all right at the moment. And it's gone.
No.
It's all over. Well, we have a bit of time left, so you carry on with you carry on playing this, and
I'm enjoying this. So I'm going to carry on. I lost by a mile there.
That was just one-sided, really. His ability to smash through those balloons was just crazy.
Got my tie.
So you've got your tie on.
I think I'm ready.
You carry on with this. While you carry on this, I'm just going to congratulate Zach and let him know what's going on. So Zach, can you hear me? Well done there. That was a bit hair-raising. You got caught on the fence.
Yes, I'm so happy. I've got reserved. I can't believe it actually got stuck, but yeah, it went well.
Well, I can tell you, Jim's still well and truly playing this. So you absolutely smashed it. So congratulations, you won it this time.
Yes, that's so good. Cheers, guys.
Fantastic. Well, we'll see you another time, Zach.
See you later.
Congratulations. Well done. And back to Jim on the game here. Where are you getting there?
I've got there. I'm getting married.
Okay, well, your challenge now is no longer to fight a Jim.
Oh, look at the obstacles I put in my way. Come on, who puts that down tonight? Pardon me.
Your challenge now is you've got less than a minute to get yourself married. In fact, you've got about 20 seconds before the end of the segment, so come on, so get yourself married quickly.
I'm there.
Give him a ring.
Give her a kiss.
Where's the best man?
Isn't the ring? He's not here.
I don't think you're even going to do this.
There it is. I've just got to put it on her finger.
Jim, it's another challenge you've lost, but a valiant effort, and congratulations to Zach once again.
I got it. Hold up. Put it on your finger, love. Come on, put your hand up. There we go.
She's got the rest. Brilliant. That was crazy.
It's quite sweet, actually, isn't it?
Coming up!
In Zaire.
Oh, well, he got a sort of a hit by default there.
Studio guests.
Our guest this week was having global hits before I was born.
Me too, actually. His Muhammad Ali-inspired hit Black Superman peaked at number 7 in the UK charts, reached number 1 in Australia and many other countries, and spent a whopping 6 months in the US Billboard Hot 100.
His top 10 hit In Zaire, also about Ali, had great success across Europe and has been re-recorded and sampled by numerous artists. Johnny Wakelin, thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Well, it's our pleasure, absolutely our pleasure. Well, obviously, you're a man with amazing experience in the music industry and what an amazing career. So, maybe give us an idea of where it all started and what ultimately led to the songs about Muhammad Ali.
Well, I started singing when I was about 20, which is millions of years ago.
Surely not.
I always wanted to get into the big time, so I thought, well, the only way to do this is to start writing songs, and I wrote a few duff ones that were quite amusing to some
people. Probably where everyone starts.
And but then I thought, well, I've got to write about something that somebody knows, you know, that lots of people are keen on. And I ended up writing this song about Muhammad Ali, and you know, it's just that I was a big fan as well of boxing in general, and especially of him. And I wrote this thing in one evening, and away it went.
Just came to you.
Yeah.
So, of course, the song you're talking about is Black Superman, which we can listen to a little bit of now.
Muhammad, the Black Superman, who calls to the other guy, Ali. Catch me if you can.
You got to know Muhammad Ali, didn't you?
I did.
Coffees and penthouses and the likes of that.
Yeah, I met him 3 times, twice in London, when we were trying to promote the Black Superman, and he just won the fight that took place in Zaire against George Foreman, and he was doing a tour of the country, doing talk shows here, there, and everywhere. And we sort of gate crashed that and said, look, we've got a record about you. Would you like to hear it? And he said, yes, I would. So he got all this gear put up on the stage, and it was only a little tiny gear, massive big sort of auditorium, and it's a little set that you'd have indoors, you know. Yeah. But he could hear it, and he loved it, and it, thank God we did that, because the next day he told the press that what a wonderful song it was by this guy from Sussex, and
what amazing and, pressure that must have been,
yeah,
you know.
And so that prompted the radio to play it, so that was great. And but I did meet him twice more. Once was in again in London when he was staying at the Inn on the Park in off Park Lane, I think it was, and I was invited there to, you know, to have coffee with him and chat, how's it going, you know. Wow. That kind of thing.
Was he as charismatic in person? Oh, was, yeah, he as outgoing in he person as we see?
I mean,
him
at that
TV?
Time, a lot of people disliked him because he had a very brash attitude.
Sure.
Oh, yes.
Very. But that was just... That
he
was
talked
put
the
on.
Talk, but he certainly walked the walk as well.
Yeah. That was put on. He was a really, really nice guy. You know, yeah. It's a shame that he's in the situation he's in
indeed,
now.
Indeed.
Because I'm exceedingly jealous. You actually was in Zaire during the fight, weren't you?
So yes.
You witnessed the fight, which inspired the
I
song.
Did.
And then you had a number of other hits, and one of my favourites is Dr. Frankenstein's Disco Party. Now,
yeah,
one can understand why
to
one
on
would
Halloween
do
show in some way.
One can understand why In Zaire was inspired by being in Zaire. What the hell inspired you to write Dr. Frankenstein?
Well, no, I'll just stop you there because I didn't write Dr. Frankenstein.
An exclusive, you heard it here.
You heard it here first.
Dr. Frankenstein Disco Party.
It was a bit mad, but it was a good song to do, and I was quite pleased to do it.
Fat Boy Slim, Norman Cook himself,
yes,
said to you, did you know that this band are about to have a hit with your record?
Yeah. Well, I knew Norman through a guy called called Kevin Stagg, whose studio I used, and who Norman was using at the time. And he came in one day while I was there, and he had this big 12-inch record and said, you got to look into this because there could be some money in this for you. So I said, really? And he showed me the thing, and it was by a group in a black group, funny enough, in Italy, who'd done a version of In Zaire. They didn't call it that. It was called In Zaire Business for some reason.
Okay.
But it was my track going on.
Yeah.
With all the drums and all the bits that people know about, you know, and there's me singing in the background, In Zaire, In Zaire.
Yeah.
And they just added a rap to it, which was nothing to do with
they
my
talked
song.
Over your record.
And and it was a club hit, apparently. And Norman Fatboy, he said, you know, if this crosses over to the main charts, you'll have a big hit on your hands. I got 60% of the publishing.
As you said,
and the people that did it, that made it, were trying to get away with it. You know?
Of course, yeah.
There's a lesson to be learned there. Don't try to steal people's
good
songs.
To know
fortunately, my publishers got onto it when I told them. And they, I didn't know that. I didn't know anything about it.
Studio guest, communal retro video game challenge.
Well, as always, we invite our studio guests to take on our studio guest communal retro video game
retro
challenge.
Retro video game challenge!
Challenge!
Yes.
And this is no different, as we asked Johnny, who I gather is not a huge gamer per se, to take it on. So, Johnny, if you can start getting going by pressing the red start button. And if you turn up to go up to champion, press go
push
up on the
stick.
And
go.
Now press red again.
Start again. There we go.
And one more time.
One more time, and then we're going to get to the character selection screen where you can select which character you'd like to be. So these are the set of characters. The flashing box indicates which one you've selected. You can just select that one if you like, or just go through the list and hit a button and choose which one you want.
That one?
Yeah, you can go for
whatever
Guile.
You like. Yep.
Is that start again?
Yep. That's fine.
Guile.
So here
Guile
we go.
Is for Guile, but who is
he's going to be playing Dalsim.
It's Dalsim again.
Dalsim keeps popping
keeps
up,
popping
doesn't
up.
He?
I don't know what that is.
Okay, so best of luck, Johnny. You can smash him. You're playing the brown-suited, blonde-quiffed person over there.
That's it.
So hit buttons if all else fails and smash him. And,
just hit lots of buttons and see what happens. Oh, well, he got a sort of a hit by default there. Oh, he's been hit by a fireball. This is not going
to
be well.
You're going to have to start hitting
just
buttons.
Just hit some buttons there, Johnny. Just hit whatever buttons you like. That's it. Just hit them. Just, you know,
hit
start hitting them furiously.
As fast as you can and you might stand a chance. So
Oh, look at that, a back body drop, and he's doing well.
You're doing quite well.
Johnny knows what he's doing. He's got a strategy. He's scoping Dalsum out. Dalsum sort of dancing around like some crazy man and not really hitting. Oh, look at that, he's got Dalsum down to low health. This could go well.
It's neck and neck.
So you can
get towards him, smack him a few more times. Oh, it's all over this time around. Okay, well, round one goes to Dalsum.
Well, that was the first round, Johnny. You've got a second round to see what you can do against Dalsum. He's doing his funny little dance there. He's very happy, but it's not over yet. It is not over yet.
We'd recommend some more button mashing. Try to hit more buttons quickly when you get close to him and see if you can do something. So,
oh, he's biding his time. He's psyching him out. That's a nice little spinny kick there. Oh, Dalsum's got the scope of him. Oh, no, and he's thrown him across. And you don't want to get done by a perfect here, Johnny, if you can avoid it. Oh, go on, just hit some buttons there. Hit some buttons, Johnny. There we go.
It looks like it's all going to be over.
He got one back. Just saved himself from the perfect, and it is all over. That is all she wrote. Dalsum is doing his silly dance of doom. The fight is finished. And what is the final score? 2,400 points. Where does that put you
on? It puts you just above Paul Zenon, who was second from the last. So you're third from the last. So you're no way the worst.
You did slightly better than Paul Zenon, not to be ashamed of that at all, Johnny. There, you've done very well. You're not bottom of the leaderboard, and considering you've never played it before, I'd like to say congratulations and thank you for taking on the challenge.
Thank you.
Well, that's almost all we've got time for this week, but we can't end the show without announcing the winner of our special BN1 Games bundle. We ask you to tweet us with the answer to what's the best thing about being a zombie?
That's right. We had lots of great replies, and thanks to everyone who entered the competition. But we had to narrow it down, and these are what we reckon to be the best answers. So let's have a look, shall we? First of all, Rosie Kirk said in her reply, the best thing about being a zombie is the all-you-can-eat buffet.
That, I can imagine that would be good.
That's a pretty good reply there, and that must be very applicable. There's plenty of food to go around when you're a zombie. Chris Kempshall tweeted us, you get to eat such interesting people.
Oh, clever there.
Clever.
I see what you did there. That's quite clever. My favourite one, though. This is my favourite one. It was someone put a limerick together, which is pretty cool.
Which is very clever, especially in a tweet. The best thing about being a Zed is filling the world with dread. You can sit there and groan, and no one will moan. And when they're not looking, they're dead.
We like that.
That's pretty clever. That's your favourite. My personal favourite, though, I think this is very witty. This is from Dion Lay. The best thing about being a zombie is being part of a thriving community who share the same interests.
Oh, very good.
So that tickles me. That tickles me.
So we're divided. These two were the ones that stuck out. We got the limerick, or we've got that one. I think there's only one fair way of sorting this.
There's only one fair way. We've got to ask our guest here, Johnny.
Johnny, we're going to ask you.
Which thing's better, the limerick or the thriving community who share the same interests?
It's all down to you, and the winner will get this game's bundle. So,
well, as a writer myself, I would have to go for the limerick one.
Oh, fantastic!
There you go. Terra9God or GOD, you are the winner of our bundle. Congratulations! We'll be sending it through to you, and we'll send you details very, very soon.
So there you go. Well, Johnny, thanks for choosing that, and thanks for coming on our show. Make sure to hit us up on all the usual social media sources on our website, and until next week, game on!
Blah blah blah.